Would you believe me if I told you there are places in the US that can become walkable, car-free cities within a decade or two? Let me show you what I mean. Generally in America, there's this belief that if you want an urban life, you need to accept a few conditions. One of these conditions is that driving is all but mandatory. Yes, even in cities. Due to the way American planning tends to work, being able to walk or bike in an urban environment as a daily form of transport is something exceedingly rare, rather than a normal benefit of city living. Going back to the 1920s and 1930s, many cities in America had streetcar networks, the same way many cities today have a citywide bus network, or if you are very lucky, a comprehensive metro system. There were entire communities then built on the idea that you could take a streetcar from your suburban house for a 30-minute commute into the nearest major city. Cities across the nation, like Los Angeles, Salt Lake City, New Orleans, all the way up to Philadelphia, had communities just like this. You see, back in the day, driving a car was the domain of the Rockefellers. It was a national event as well for Eisenhower across the country prior to the introduction of the interstate highway system. They had to teach children in schools during the 1930s that the road was the domain of the Model T, not of their parents getting groceries or their friends playing soccer. I think I can strongly argue that this generation was the last in America where living without a car wouldn't hinder your standard of living if you were outside of an urban core. Gone was whatever cafe culture America may have developed or third place pub culture. Instead, we were told to get in the metal box, go to work, go to church, and use the roads for nothing else. In the following decades, car-centric development, single-family zoning, and a sharp drop-off in transit investment made going back to the days where pedestrian traffic was treated equally to motorists nearly impossible. Transit investment was never fully defunded, mind you, but services have been made so unreliable in all but the most populous cities, whether because of reduced service or no way to serve the subsequent sprawling communities, that it's a moot point. Today, only 40 major cities have light rail networks, and of those, only 30 have over 10 miles of track. Luckily, some regions didn't rip everything up when the car came around. New England, I would argue, is a great area and a testing ground for reigniting transit-oriented development. To give an example of a typical town, let me show you Ansonia, or wait, is this Shelton? Whichever historic Connecticut industrial town this happens to be, we can see that there's a fairly sizable main street with shops, sidewalks, and medium density, multi-story buildings that can be walked to. The area can easily be redeveloped or built upon if the town wants to do so. And the streets, believe it or not, are actual streets, not these kind of strode street-road hybrids. I took this photo while I was on my trip back to Connecticut, and I think it gives you a very good impression of what the average main street can be built upon. Despite many cities in the region feeling fairly suburban, there's less induced demand than elsewhere, and more capability for simple zoning regulations to change the landscape in profound ways. Towns like this are a relic. They are exceedingly rare, but I could see that these medium-density towns can come back. In the wake of people just wanting to live in a more built-up but cost-effective place. With enough investment in towns like these, the ideal of a modern transit-friendly city can be built up on the backbone of what came before and still stands today. Like many people, I left New England for college, and what I quickly noticed was that public transit became a rarity. It wasn't just something I could use or expect to have access to. Simply living in the city didn't cut it. You need to be lucky enough to pick a good neighborhood or live directly downtown and be able to pay for that privilege. If only 40 cities in the country have light rail, think of what that means on average for American urban life, and how people without a car are able to live in places which lack a light rail system. To me, the fact that every state capital in the country doesn't have some kind of mass transit network speaks volumes to transit being a privilege, not an expectation. Washington, D.C. is one of two major cities I can see having the capability to embody this new ideal. The local joke is that the metro system operates every 5, 15, or 30 minutes, depending on how many lines are on fire that day. DC, keep in mind, is highly regarded in the US for its transit network, simply because it exists. Arlington County today has embarked on an urban village project closer to the border with DC as a way to emulate transit-oriented development found elsewhere in the world in light of its heavily suburbanized nature. This type of development may become a model to transform transit across the region. For those of us just entering the workforce who aspire to live in a place where we can reduce our car usage or go entirely car-free without going broke, we are limited to quite a few cities and regions. I hope I presented a few good examples where these ideas can be brought to reality. No matter how many light rail lines you put up in LA, Houston, or Raleigh, they'll never be as viable as Chicago, DC, or New England unless you rapidly scale up the density around transit lines, which is about as likely as me becoming a millionaire. For those of you who've made it to the end, thank you so much. I appreciate you immensely. If you like what you've seen, please feel free to drop a comment, share this video around, or hit the like button.